Penguin Random House Audio presents 40 Ways to Look at Winston Churchill, a brief account of a long life. This is the author, Gretchen Rubin. Note to listeners, this program includes a bonus PDF with additional resources. To my mother and father. We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender. Winston Churchill, address to the House of Commons, June 4th, 1940. Many scenes have come and gone unwritten since it is today, the 4th September, a cold, gray, blowy day, made memorable by the sight of a kingfisher and by my sense, waking early, of being again visited by the spirit of delight. Rarely, rarely comest thou, spirit of delight. That was I singing this time last year, and sang so poignantly that I have never forgotten it, or my vision of a fin rising on a wide, blank sea. No biographer could possibly guess this important fact about my life in the late summer of 1926. Yet biographers pretend they know people. Virginia Woolf, Diaries, September 4th, 1927. Introduction. I know exactly when my obsession with Winston Churchill began. On a plane from New York City to Anchorage, while I was reading a World War II history that described a scene at Churchill's country house. Prime Minister Churchill, we learn, had standing orders that he was to be awakened before 8 a.m. only if Britain itself was invaded. Sometime after 8, one morning in 1941, Foreign Secretary Anthony Eden answered a knock by Churchill's valet, who presented him with a cigar on a silver tray. He said, "The Prime Minister's compliments, and the German armies have invaded Russia." Churchill, what a character! Not to be disturbed in sleep even for such extraordinarily good news for Britain, and then to celebrate by sending around a cigar with that wonderful message. The Prime Minister's compliments, and the German armies have invaded Russia. I wanted to read more. Like many people born after Churchill's death in 1965, I knew little about him. He'd been a great prime minister during that war, and he'd given a famous speech about this was their finest hour, and after Lady Astor snapped, "Winston, if I were your wife, I'd put poison in your coffee," he'd retorted, "Nancy, if I were your husband, I'd drink it." That was about the extent of my knowledge. I dog-eared the page to remind myself to track down a Churchill biography. But later at the library, the huge and often multi-volume biographies daunted me. And when I turned instead to read Churchill himself, I faced his 5-volume history of World War I, his 6-volume history of World War II, and his 4-volume history of the English-speaking peoples. I didn't know where to start. I wanted to know something about Churchill, but not everything about him. But I was lucky. I made just the right choice. Churchill's partial memoir, My Early Life. The man was a James Bond who'd actually lived, the hero of a novel that really happened. I was enthralled by Churchill's fantastic successes and failures, by his outsized character, and by his historic vision. And his writing was so masterful. I found myself rereading passages to savor his words. He wrote, "The senior officers consulted together. As so often happens when things go wrong, formalities were discarded, and I found myself taking part in the discussion." Of his obnoxious ambition as a young soldier, Churchill wrote, "The expressions metal hunter and self-advertiser were used from time to time, in a matter which would, I am sure, surprise and pain the readers of these notes. It is melancholy to be forced to record these less amiable aspects of human nature, which by a most curious and indeed unaccountable coincidence have always seemed to present themselves in the wake of my innocent footsteps. The book's closing paragraph was unforgettable. It read, "Events were soon to arise in the fiscal sphere which were to plunge me into new struggles and absorb my thoughts and energies at least until September 1908, when I married and lived happily ever afterwards." He published this memoir in 1930. After that first book, I read one volume after another about Churchill and by Churchill. The scope of his life and experience overwhelmed me. Just consider that Churchill was born in 1874, the American Civil War ended in 1865, and lived to age 90, entered Parliament first in 1900 at age 25, held 7 cabinet positions between 1908 and 1940, was Prime Minister twice, and finally retired in 1964 at age 89. He lived in a time of tremendous change. He fought in a British cavalry charge using lances as weapons. Already a cabinet member in 1910, Churchill urged that Britain contact the Wright brothers. He'd heard about the invention of the airplane. He died the year Malcolm X was shot. As I plunged into his life, a truth, often noted, often overlooked, confronted me. Churchill's portrait could be drawn in innumerable ways, all true. I was struck to see his biographers reach different conclusions from the same facts. Was Churchill a military genius or a meddling amateur? Was he a great defender of liberty or a reactionary imperialist? Was he a success or a failure? Once I had command of the material, I amused myself by tracing how each account exaggerated certain details and slid over others to support its conclusions. Some issues are complex, so it's unsurprising that biographers weigh the evidence differently or reach contradictory conclusions. But often, even a seemingly straightforward fact takes on a different character when related by different biographers. For example, in his fascinating account, The Duel, Hitler versus Churchill, John Lucas observes, "Churchill, unlike Hitler, was a man of unrepressed feelings. Tears, on some occasions, would come into his eyes." This is quite an understatement. Churchill, in fact, cried often and abundantly. He could have filled buckets, according to one colleague. Perhaps Lucas didn't feel comfortable with the notion of a weepy Churchill. Sometimes I detect a biographer's reading too much into facts, supplying motives or states of mind without any apparent evidence. William Manchester's engaging biography, Churchill, Visions of Glory, describes a photograph of Churchill's mother, Jenny Jerome, when she was in her late teens. He wrote, "Dark, vivacious and magnificent, she stands alone, staring boldly at the photographer, her left arm outflung, the hand atop a frilled umbrella, her hips cocked saucily. It is almost a wanton pose, the posture of a virgin who can hardly wait to assume another position." How in the world, I asked myself as I studied the picture, did Manchester come up with all that? To me, it looked like a picture of a mother and her 3 daughters decked out in Victorian finery. True, Jenny had her hand on an umbrella, and true, later in her life she'd have many lovers, but her hips didn't look cocked, and her posture certainly didn't look wanton. This description seemed to tell more about Manchester than about Jenny Jerome. The distortions of a writer's viewpoint are even more apparent in a memoir. The diary of Churchill's carping, self-important doctor, Lord Moran, is an amusing example of dramatic irony. There's quite a gap between what Lord Moran said happened and what the reader thinks happened. Lord Moran relates a conversation with Churchill about Churchill's fits of depression, or black dog, which Moran considered quite serious. Moran said, "Your trouble, I mean the black dog business, you got from your forebears. You have fought against it all your life." That is why you dislike visiting hospitals. You always avoid anything that is depressing. Winston stared at me as if I knew too much. Conceited Lord Morin thought Churchill stared at him as if he knew too much. I suspected Churchill was thinking, "Cheek!" or, "No, I don't like visiting hospitals. Who does?" Reading multiple biographies of a single figure underscores the range of response that a fact or an event can inspire. In John Charmley's revisionist account, Churchill, The End of Glory, he quotes from Churchill's address to the House of Commons on June 4, 1940. "We shall go on to the end. We shall fight in France. We shall fight on the seas and oceans. We shall fight with growing confidence and growing strength in the air. We shall defend our island, whatever the cost may be. We shall fight on the beaches. We shall fight on the landing grounds. We shall fight in the fields and in the streets. We shall fight in the hills. We shall never surrender." Charmley admits that this speech, considered one of Churchill's most inspiring and significant, was sublime. But he concludes it was sublime nonsense. These examples illustrate the multiple interpretations and characterizations that can be given even to simple facts, and many issues are far more difficult. Was the Dardanelles strategy wrongheaded or brilliant? And how responsible was Churchill for that military disaster? Was Churchill an aristocratic snob or a friend of the working class? Why was he ousted as prime minister in 1945? Layers of facts refute one another. And there's also the question of what facts matter. For example,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.